Today, you're joining a series of webinars that we call Foresight Talks. This is part of our program of Foresight Essentials, which is where we provide all our professional training on futures thinking. And let me take you through a few slides. So today we're gonna be joined by our guest, Julieta Matos Castaño. And we're gonna hear a lot about smart cities, the ethics of technology and how to deploy technologies when we think about values and intentions. We'll have some time for Q&A, but let me tell you a little bit more about IFTF. We've been around since 1968. We've been around a little while. We're based in Silicon Valley, and we provide tools, research, and programs that help people and organizations turn foresight into insights for the next decade. Ultimately, what we're interested in is helping people and organizations anticipate the future, come up with insights for transforming their lives and the world around them. Like I said, this session is part of our Foresight Essentials program, where we really have a really large portfolio of training opportunities. For individuals, we have our signature Foresight Essentials course, where we teach all of our core tools that we combine in multiple ways to do the work that we do, and hopefully you can incorporate them into your practice. We also have a class on design futures and scenario building. Some of you may have seen us on Coursera. We have a lot of resources there, so we invite you to take advantage of that. Increasingly, we're also creating custom trainings for organizations and even what we're calling future back or backcasting accelerators for organizations that want to do some focus work on some strategic issues. All right, that's our training portfolio. If you want to learn more about them, just click on the link and we can get you more information. Upcoming on our schedule, you can see we have a range of courses and offerings available, so mark your calendar. You can see that some of these are live and online, and we have some in October in Germany and in Palo Alto that are live and in person. So if you'd like to learn more about this, just let us know. This has really turned, if you've been joining us in these Foresight Talks or been part of a Foresight Essentials course, there's a really vibrant community that we have and that you can be part of. Part of that is these webinars. There's also another series called Ask a Futurist. Many people are also joining Urgent Optimist, which is a community platform. We also spend some time, if you're interested, in matching you with other Foresight professionals in a buddy program. We have a newsletter that you can join, and there are on occasion meetups. Okay. It looks like our Zoom feature and our chat is back up. Just make sure that you select all panelists and attendees. And throughout the session, you can raise questions, and Aicha will be looking at those, and then we'll try to answer them at the end of the session. Okay, let me introduce you to Julieta Matos Castaño. We're really happy to have her here with us today. If you smart city technologies, and she comes to us as a futures researcher and practitioner at the DesignLab of the University of Twente in the Netherlands. Her expertise lies in developing and experimenting with creative methods to tackle social challenges and work towards responsible innovation. She has more than 13 years experience in research and industry. She often collaborates with public institutions, businesses, and citizens to shape desirable futures. And a lot of her work aims to foster futures literacy, establish discussions around varied, relevant social topics such as privacy, smart city controversies. We're going to hear about frictions, which I love thinking about. She's also interested in the future of digital economies. So please welcome Julieta Matos Castaño. All right. Welcome. Tell us more about the work that you're doing in a moment, but I always like to learn when I encounter a new colleague, a new futurist. I always love to learn about their origin story with futures work. How did you get started in this field? What was it? What sparked your interest? Let's start there and then we'll go into your current work.
Yeah, thank you so much, Rod. And good morning, good afternoon, everybody. So it's a pleasure to be here today. And then I'm looking forward to, sharing experiences with you and then indeed talking about the smart cities. That then is a really exciting, I think, and relevant topic at the moment. Rod, to answer your question about when did I start becoming involved in futures thinking? So I think then since the beginning of my career. So I have a background in civil engineering and airport planning. So already I was dealing with futures thinking. So all these strategic decisions that then you are making while developing infrastructure, and they are going to have an impact in the futures of a city, of a region, of a country. So indirectly already at the beginning of my career, then I became very interested in, it is very important to really acknowledge that we have multiple futures ahead of us depending on the decisions that we make. And then after working as an engineer, then I got my PhD on dilemmas in infrastructure. And then the connection became more direct because then when we're encountering dilemmas, in this case, it was dilemmas of infrastructure in which we have multiple organizations working together, building a project. The way that we deal with dilemmas and then that we accept certain trade-offs, then we are going to have to, in a way, prioritize like a specific value instead of another one. So in my career, then I became very interested in dilemmas. And then also I developed a tool inspired in the design methodologies to create awareness about dilemmas and then how they impact potential futures. And then through that path, in 2018, after working as a change management consultant, and then also transformation is all about futures and then how can we anticipate and then indeed get ready, futures ready. In 2018, I joined a research project at the University of Twente, in which what we do is we develop methods and tools to reflect about smart city futures and then explore what responsibility means in smart cities. How can we incorporate multiple needs and interests? And by studying this topic and then by working on this project, then together with my colleagues, we started using and applying speculative design. We developed scenario-based tools and we really there, like not really just indirectly, but then we started really working in responsible futuring and then that field.
I love the idea that, the fact that you are an airport planner and engineer and infrastructure, I came at this through the lens of health and public health. So everyone has a story where futures thinking can have an impact. So I really love hearing this story of how it all got started for you.
Yeah, totally. And then I also think that something where I started wondering actually, and because in infrastructure and then in my previous work, I worked a lot on decision making. And then, how can we support decision-making processes that involve companies, public organizations? In this case, I was working in complex projects of what is called in the Netherlands, multifunctional flood protection projects. So then how can you combine like a flood protection with, for instance, a park or some buildings, et cetera? And then in these type of projects, then stakeholders need to select the type of function or use that then they would like to give to this project. And that really opened like this kind of possibilities of depending the projects that then you were combining, then you were going to definitely reach very different outcomes that then they were going to satisfy or prioritize specific needs. And then sometimes you had to mitigate other potential impacts that your decisions could have. So that was already early in my career. And right now I'm very excited to be working on this field of smart city futures and responsible futuring.
That's great. So let's go there. As you know, we asked everyone, what makes a city smart? We got a lot of different answers. And earlier you said, you know, a lot of your work you discovered in working with dilemmas, you ultimately have to make trade-offs. At the core of those trade-offs are a lot of choices motivated by different values possibly and other things that you want to prioritize. So I'm really curious, let's start with, how would you answer that question? What makes a city smart? And then let's go into the project that you're currently doing or recently did.
Yeah, I saw some of the answers that then they were popping up in the chat, and then I found them very, very interesting. So I think perhaps the most straightforward answer, because then many times I spend a lot of time in my work really answering the question of what is not a smart city? And then actually, when you asked that question, then I was thinking indeed. So I spent so usually smart city, and then the way it is defined is like, okay, a smart city is a city that then is using technology to collect, process and analyze data and then use it for specific urban purposes. And then that's usually when people talk about smart cities, then that's what comes to mind. But I think in my opinion, a smart city is a city that serves its citizens. And then that can be achieved through technology, that then that's definitely, it has a lot of benefits, and then it has a lot of, it offers a lot of potential opportunities to optimize processes, increase efficiency, indeed sometimes facilitate the interaction among people. But then there's more that beyond, there are a lot of smart solutions, and then there are a lot of concepts of smartness that go beyond technology. And then something that I think is that in general in the discourse of smart cities, everything revolves around quantitative elements, right? And then how can we quantify the experience in a city and a city experience? And sometimes you read reports and then it's like, okay, we are making the invisible visible. So a lot of these smart city processes that then you can get all kinds of numbers on how they are working. But a city is also qualitative. There are a lot of qualitative experiences and also values that make a city a city. So if we move, I think that in general, the values that we allocate with this smartness that then focuses a lot on quantity is all about, as I said, like efficiency, optimization, etc. But I think a city that is smart also acknowledges other values that are important. Like we, in the projects that I work together with my colleagues, then we always really like mentioning serendipity, for instance, like the possibility of finding unexpected surprises in the city. Learning about other cultures, having vibrant markets and streets. And then those are values that we cannot quantify. So that's a little bit of a long answer to your question.
That's great, because I, you know, in our work in forecasting technology here at IFTF, it wasn't too long ago where we were looking at a lot of people's forecasts in our work. And, you know, you look at across all of those things and you see that everything is being called smart. Smart tools, smart homes, smart cars, smart cities. So smartness almost loses any meaning, because if you're calling everything smart, it's almost impossible to really get at what is being enabled, what is being facilitated. So when we encountered your work and you wanted to be part of this, really digging in and looking at the values is one way. So there are many answers, but ultimately it comes to how you make those trade-offs and what you want to achieve.
Absolutely. And then I think we had a conversation, and it was also like smartness, and then the concept of smartness as well. It comes with a seamless process, right? And then really everything is smooth, and there's no friction when something is
seamless is friction free.
It has to be friction free. And then as part of our work, what we embrace actually is that the concept of smartness also, and then also unavoidably the use of technology leads to frictions and controversies and value tensions. And then we can really make constructive use of these tensions and then these controversies to think critically about the things that matter to us, but then also to come up with other solutions that can be beneficial in the city. So another answer that I could give in terms of what makes a city perhaps smart, and then what is smartness, then I could say smartness can also be indeed from embracing this frictional nature, or how to say, like staying away from, if we have a seamless, smooth experience, it is a smart experience. Mm-hmm. Is it really? Perhaps sometimes we're just not acknowledging other things that are important. Mm-hmm. So that's really what we try to do in our project with the methods and techniques that we develop.
Mm-hmm. That's great. Should we talk about, since you introduced the idea that the future is also, I mean, you could optimize for seamlessness and no friction, but your project is actually about future frictions. And I think that's a really, I think if we don't question and intentionally look in our forecasting for those frictions and try to understand them, then that's when you see a lot of forecasts that are, for example, in a city. I'm currently working on a future transportation project. So seamlessness is a big theme, and getting from point A to point B in the fastest, most efficient way. But if I want to be surprised, or I am thinking about serendipity, to your point, you know, it may not be the fastest route or the most efficient route or the cheapest route. It is something else. And that's why I think when you start thinking about these frictions and values, it opens up so many more future possibilities. That if we don't, you know, engage with values and frictions, we might not see them all.
Exactly. And I think also the main value is that when you embrace these frictions and then you acknowledge and then you try to understand where they are coming from, because, for instance, as part of our research project on responsible cities, so we have future frictions that then is a technique that we use, and then I will explain it in a bit. But then we also have some methods in which we unpack what we call, like, we try to understand the anatomy of a controversy. So then we create like a network of values, identifying like potential tensions and then also potential synergies. We're thinking about smart city futures. And then I think the main value that it has is like, if you are embracing these frictions and controversies, then you can really understand the local context. So then eventually what you can do is really, you can have a solution that is serving whatever is going to be implemented, because then those frictions are also like really context dependent. So if they really come from whoever is involved in or like actually living that situation, right, and experiencing it. And then at the same time, also something that I think it's very important, and something that we use in the project a lot, is really this creation of they foster these alternative imaginaries. Right. Mm-hmm. So when you are thinking sometimes about like, OK, then let's think about the futures of mobility or futures of many things. Right. So then these imaginaries or these visions of the future, they tend to originate from, well, already perhaps like pre-existing examples or some top-down perceptions or perspectives that already exist. But then there's a lot to learn from, and then also a lot there are a lot of possibilities to improve the city if we also create spaces, and then if we foster like the creation of these alternative imaginaries that are different, that are really a process in which you are involving, like definitely the private sector, public sector, but then also residents and citizens that are there, and then they can also share their needs or their wishes and their dreams in the city. And then I think these alternative imaginaries then naturally emerge from the frictions and then also from the tensions. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's why it's something that I think it's very important in general in futures thinking, futures design, and definitely in the context of smart cities.
That's great. Do you want to share with us more about your project? I know you prepared a demo to share with us.
Maybe yeah, definitely. Yeah, definitely. So we have been talking also about future frictions, and well, future frictions is one of the outcomes of our research project. So we work on a project that it's called Responsible Cities. It is together with universities and then also partners from the industry and the public sector, and our main goal is to stimulate ethical reflection on the impacts of technology on society and in the city, and then really to experiment with this with creative forms of engagement. So really experiment with different methods and techniques in order to create these alternative imaginaries that I was mentioning. And one of the outcomes is this tool that then is called Future Frictions. And I have a short 1 minute video that really gives a little bit of an impression on how future frictions looks like. So I'm going to share my screen, play the video, and then I will tell a little bit more about it.
Great.
See, and then, oh, sorry. Let's see. Now, okay, so that's the small demo of Future Frictions. Then for the full experience, I think on the link of the conversation, then there was also a link to the website of our project. But what do we see here? So actually, Future Frictions is it is a web experience. And then what we do is we engage people to, as I said, like to reflect, to engage in ethical reflection about the impacts of technology in society, and then really create, like come up with these alternative imaginaries of a smart city. What happens, and then the way it works is that you enter a neighborhood, and then in this neighborhood, then you, perhaps I can also share this, I can share this, these slides, and then with images. So you enter a neighborhood, and then you meet, let's see, it's not going to the next slide. Yeah, now you enter a neighborhood, you explore the neighborhood, and then you meet different citizens and then residents living in the neighborhood. So then these can be regular people. So from a teenage girl, a painter in the street, a policymaker, and then you interact with them. So as you can tell, it is it represents actually a city in the Netherlands. So then it is pretty relatable, looks like a usual city here in Europe. And then what you do after interacting with the citizens, at some point, participants or users, then they encounter different smart city technologies, in this case, three. So then they encounter a surveillance drone, then they also encounter an AI cat that then visits people who feel lonely. And then they also encounter like some sensing pigeons that then they help the city to deal with waste management. And people have to make decisions about like how these technologies are going to be used. So how is the data going to be stored and then eventually used? So they make a choice and then they make a selection. So in this case, it is about the AI cat. And then immediately what happens is that the city changes. So the impacts, the decisions that they have made, then they have an immediate impact in the city. And then not only in the city, but then also on how those neighbors that they met at the beginning, how they are also perceiving the city. So then in a way, what we are doing is we are bringing potential futures to the present. And then eventually at the end of the experience, then they have like some time to really reflect about, okay, what type of thoughts, what type of things they could think of after experiencing future fictions. I don't know if there was enough time actually in the slide, like to have a look at the choices, but we have a couple of things in mind. And then one is none of the choices that people make to use that technology are actually desirable ones. So in general, we're offering people like you can have like an individual use, the neighbors are going to be using it, or perhaps the government is going to have full control. And then what we want to do, and the way the reasoning behind it is that, okay, none of those choices are desirable. They are actually quite provocative. Mm-hmm. So if you don't want any of this, then what is it that you want? So what's the thing that you would like to have? And that we have observed is that that leads to very inspiring conversations among people when they use it together in a group. So we can use it in, you can use it as an individual experience, but then we also use it in workshop settings with practitioners. But then we are also very lucky to have the possibility of using it in educational programs in the Netherlands, and then also with some international partners. And it's something that we are also in our project particularly excited about is that, well, we showcased it at the Dutch Design Week, and then that was one of the first iterations of Future Fictions. And then we engaged with visitors of the Dutch Design Week. We learned from it, and then eventually, the last iteration of the web experience has been displayed also in a public library here in the Netherlands with visitors, and then just with residents to engage with the tool. And then really we placed next to Future Frictions a box, and then people could actually share with us their wishes for a smart city after experiencing Future Frictions. So then this is the way in which we're bringing to life these creative forms of engagement that I was mentioning at the beginning. So that's Future Frictions.
That's great. I'm curious, you know, in doing your work and using this tool and simulation, what are you learning about? Maybe what are some of the more speculative values or more instructive values to consider as we're trying to design and deploy so-called smart technologies at the city level? So I'm really curious, like some of the things that I think about, you know, like a value of participation, making a city more participatory, or making a city more shareable. Or I know one of the things that we encounter in a lot of our city work right now, especially in the context of the climate crisis, is how do we reclaim streets for humans, right? Cars occupy so much of the public space in our cities. And you know, how can we deploy technologies to sort of reclaim that public space for humanity or for nature and rewilding it? So I'm just curious, like, what are some of the values, even frictions? I mean, the climate crisis is a huge one that you've maybe encountered in your work that gives us a sense of, like, what's the edge of this domain?
Yeah, so it is, so what is quite interesting is like, so then we also, while designing future frictions, then we were also, as part of our work and then also designers of the tool, then we were embedding specific controversies that then we had in mind. So we were also embedding, for instance, like a potential friction between individual values or preferences and convenience against, for instance, specific collective values, right? So then that sometimes there might come an intention. So we had something in mind, but then we also kept it. So ambiguity was very important. So then we had really left it very open for interpretation. So nothing is really very good or very bad, or then really steering towards a specific value in future frictions. And then what we have noticed is like that has a lot of a value in the tool, because then depending on the group with whom you're using it, then you get indeed like different types of discussions. So there's one discussion that it always happens, of course, and then it's a discussion that revolves around privacy, then the importance of privacy, and then how are you going to ensure that then, for instance, if you're going to help somebody in need, then that might be great, but then what about the privacy, and then how are you going to do it? But then a couple of things that come to mind is like, one, and then that is connected to how are we going to reclaim our streets, is one of the discussions that we had was about like, how can we, let's say, like about childhood, and then how can we also acknowledge children in our cities. Mm-hmm. And then how could we perhaps incorporate like an embed like some values that are more connected to, well, like children, but then also certain values that matter a lot when we are of a young age. And then I remember that in this session, then the whole discussion and the whole controversy was around that. But then also a lot of the conversation revolved around the control of technology. So depending on who is going to be behind the technology, certain things seem to be desirable, certain things seem to be undesirable, and then that leads to a very, very interesting discussions. Issues also of exclusion and inclusion, that then, for instance, with the artificial intelligence cat, that then, of course, is completely speculative, but many people are also talking about like, okay, then at some point then the cat might help a lot of people, but then sometimes then they might be identified, you know, like they might have a label that then they need something. Mm-hmm. And then who's going to determine that they are in need, right? And then what if other people are in need, and then everything is being prioritized to those that the cat is deciding? So I think most of the discussions and the conversations revolve around that. But the one that I found most interesting was how can we indeed give more, I don't know if we would call them like childhood-like, or more like the values of children and the values to the city. And mm-hmm. Is that possible? And then is that desirable? And then how could we make it happen? But it's really always every session leads to different discussions, which yeah. I think
I love it. That's a really provocative question. It immediately makes me think of how do you turn, you know, the urban landscape into a playground? How is it, you know, fun or discovery, you know, depending on, yeah, how you think about kids. Let's open it up to some questions. I have a few. Serena May is asking, how does the tool map out the consequences of the choices? Through AI or a decision tree that the human programs, is the question.
Yeah, so in this case, we created a decision tree So what we did is we created different scenarios with different, let's say, characters that then they were part of the scenario. And then we created decision trees and mapped out potential consequences so that then the decisions could have. So then in this case, it was us as developers of the tool that then show like these consequences. But then also something that we wanted to do, and then perhaps that I don't know if I mentioned it, but it is also to show to participants and then the users of future frictions that we can also influence how this technology is being used, and then our choices matter. And our choices matter, and then sometimes there are unintended consequences because sometimes also future frictions being a little bit provocative, it really shows consequences that people didn't expect. Like for instance, with the AI cat, then everything is great, the nurse is really happy, but there are like these signs everywhere in the city, like saying like, here lives a lonely person, and people are saying like, oh, did you know that then that person is feeling lonely? So they're being labeled.
I'm not sure that lonely people want to be labeled lonely.
Exactly. So we mapped out, so then there was a decision tree, and then this was also a co-creation. So we did it, a group of researchers from the University of Twente and Utrecht University, and then together with our partners from the project. So then involving the municipality, a design agency, lawyers, etc. And then we engaged in a series of co-creation sessions, and together we mapped out the different consequences.
That's interesting. We have a question also that's asking, how do you invite people to imagine more scenarios around responsible cities? So yeah. I guess it's, yeah, like who's imagining in your
session? And then this is also something that we
Exactly.
So the point that we want to mention is like, actually, everybody has the power actually to imagine, right? So then we invite everybody to imagine. Something that we learned using future frictions is that the tool is as important as the process that then you're embedding the tool, in which you're embedding the tool, right? So then you can have future frictions as a standalone tool that then it really... you can engage in reflection, etc. But then when we are using it in a workshop setting, or where we are also like using it together with a group of people, that then it can be definitely with citizens as well. In that process, then we invite people like to really reflect about potential controversies that they perceived, potential controversies that they could think of after experiencing future frictions. And then we also invite them to say, okay, what kind of alternative imaginary? What are, perhaps it's not part, you haven't seen it in future frictions, because it, as I said, it is quite provocative, but what are the things that then you wish, and then what are the imaginaries? And then that's part as a, like of an exercise, of a follow-up exercise after experiencing the tool. And then I think that's also something very important that we learned. The tool is as important as the process and the context in which we are using it. Mm-hmm. So something important. Yeah, sorry.
No. You have me thinking, there's another question about asking if you can point to specific things that you incorporated into your city designs based on your work. And they're asking about aspects of park designs or changes in transportation. And it occurred to me, at least in your simulation, you're kind of at the neighborhood level, but you know, there's different scales of the city. And I'm curious about that, but I'm also curious about, are there specific urban or city designs that you're also testing or incorporating in your work?
Yeah, so as part of what is future frictions, then it's one of the outcomes, and we really focus on an experience. So then really the experience of a neighborhood. So right. It is really, we are focusing on how would you experience such a neighborhood, then you can choose this technology. So
it's a nice unit of analysis. So exactly. Yeah, experiences in the city.
Exactly, because then we were also thinking, so eventually the point that we want to make is that you can have the higher level specific policy decisions or decisions that are going to be happening, like the more of a at the larger level, that they are going to impact that experience. So perhaps at the higher level is like, indeed, we are kind of playing that actually it is people making that decision and then perhaps like implementing that policy. So then it's happening directly there in the neighborhood. But then we really work on that level of analysis. When we are looking more at changes of transportation or, for instance, at the higher level, then we have other tools that then we're also using as part of the project that then is not necessarily future frictions. And then, for instance, these network of conflicts methods that then I mentioned and technique. So usually we have a scenario, and then that scenario, we have an already made scenario that then we can bring, and then with different stakeholders and then stakeholder perspectives that then we can deliver as a fictional case, but then people can also bring their own. And then they can imagine, like imagine that it is the year 2030, and then this is the scenario, this is what is happening in the city. And then people can take stakeholder roles and then map what we call like value mapping, mm-hmm. and then identify like the tensions, synergies, and then they can really reframe the challenge at hand based on the understanding that they get from that network. And then I think that that can be applied at a higher level. So then depending if you're talking about indeed like waste management in the city, right? So then you have a solution. And then with that, so it is related to systemic design. So then you can really map and then see the interdependencies and then the how the different stakeholders and what matters to them are going to be connected, and they are going to be influencing at the end everything as a whole. So it becomes quite complex, but it allows to get an understanding on where the different consequences are coming from.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, I always think that's one of sort of the capabilities that futures work sort of demands of you, which is to embrace all that complexity, at least at some part of your project or work, because I think that's where you definitely start to draw lots of connections and see a lot of different things. One of the areas that people are asking is about aging, since we know the world is aging, and they're asking about age-ready cities and to what extent. I know it looked like it was a theme in your simulation and your tool, but the question is, you know, how does your work take aging and age-ready cities into account?
That is a very very important point. And indeed, in future frictions, when also when we were developing the simulation, then many times, and then especially also like, well, in our research, and then when we are talking about like coming back at the beginning of the talk, like really smart solutions. So there's a lot of like, there's not a lot of digital literacy, right? So then many times there's also an aging population. And then sometimes in many parts of the world, they don't have a smartphone, right? And then, I don't know, in the Netherlands, for instance, to register to certain things in the government, then you need to do everything digitally and online. And then it's very fast. But then some people, and then I remember in the box that we put in Future Frictions in the municipality, there was somebody, I don't know the age of this person, but then this person said, you know, I am of an older generation, and then I actually don't have a smartphone. So please, municipality, help me to deal with certain things, right? Mm-hmm. So we are not really doing it explicitly. It is not like, in general, like the values that then we unpack and then the values that then we discover in our methods. So we bring the techniques to the context, and then it is people really bringing them to the surface. So it is a topic that I think through especially digital accessibility and literacy, it has come several times, but then not explicitly. And then I think it's definitely very relevant. So then it's something that we could perhaps also make more explicit in our activities and workshops. Mm-hmm. But in that case, yeah, I have seen it sometimes. Like I don't have a computer, So
yeah. I always wonder about this. I mean, I really appreciate the question because it always makes me think of, you know, if we're trying to understand what makes a city smart, or even kind of a qualitative metric that you mentioned earlier, like what makes a city vibrant? It makes me want to ask, are technologies always part of the equation? Because if you're trying to make a city smart or vibrant, or to facilitate more social connection, it doesn't always need to involve technology. So I'm just wondering, how does that come up in your work? Because I imagine, you know, once you're in the mindset of thinking about optimizing or choosing different values, then the kinds of actions certainly are beyond what you're doing with technology.
Exactly. I think so. Something that, as part of our team, then we always keep in mind is like, so technology is indeed a means to an end. And then the first, what we need to do is really, where is the challenge that then we are addressing? So what is the potential opportunity? What could we achieve? And then, is technology an option? If it is an option, then let's reflect on the potential implications. But sometimes in some of the talks and the lectures that I give at the university, I give this example in Bogota, I think it was in Colombia. So they had a traffic problem. So I don't know if you're familiar with this. They had a traffic problem. There were a lot of traffic jams. And actually the municipality—
Like a common urban challenge.
Yeah. Exactly. And it's been a while since the last time I told this story, but what happened was, like, actually the municipality wanted to implement like sensors and then really go smart, like through technology. Mm-hmm. And there was this mayor, and then he said, oh, what if we actually, in every traffic light, then there will be mimes, so like like really warning drivers, I think, because it was a question of there were some accidents and then people were behaving like very impatiently. And then they started to experiment with some kind of small performances in the traffic lights. And actually that solution, that then it is not actually a technology driven, but it was incredibly, incredibly both effective and efficient. So that was always like, that's always an example that I give as, we need to dare to imagine things differently. So who could come up with this kind of solution, right? So it is possible if you create like these alternative imaginaries.
That's such a great story, because we're being asked, you know, since you are researching essentially the future of cities and smart cities, what are your favorite cities and any other lessons from those cities that are your favorite?
Yeah, well, that's a very difficult question. I think, for instance, so in terms of cities are dealing with the concept of smartness and then also the digital city, I think the municipality of Amsterdam is doing a lot of exciting work, and then they are very committed to, let's say, the ethical use of technology. So, for instance, they implemented something that they call the TADA principles. So these are some principles that then they co-created with multiple stakeholders, that they are the values governing all the technology that is going to be implemented in the city. And they are really taking it very seriously. So they involved a lot of people in the process. Then they were identifying like potential technological dilemmas. And then I think that's they have a very active platform. And these five principles are very simple. They can be applied to many different types of projects. And they are really governing a lot of initiatives. And then I think they are a very good example in taking it very seriously. Like really these ethical aspects and then having an ethical commission. And then here in the Netherlands, also like at the provincial and regional level, then there's another province like in South Holland, and they have also recently opened like an ethical commission and department in which they are constantly well, evaluating and analyzing like potential ethical implications of technology. So I think those are cities that I know very well, because then I'm usually in touch with them, and then so then those are examples that I think they are doing great work. Yeah.
We have lots of questions, and I think maybe we can squeeze in one more. I'm really curious. So there's a couple of questions maybe we combined. There's this question about things, you know, any lessons about what we shouldn't do when we're planning for smart cities. And then there's this other question about is it, help us think about, you know, maybe some differences from planning a smart city from scratch or retrofitting a city to make it smart. So really about, maybe it's too much, but maybe it's more lessons about what not to do when trying to build out a smart city.
I think, so for that, so in like the first answer that comes to mind is like, do not look at technology. So if you're thinking, so the first thing is indeed think about the challenge and the urban challenge or the urban opportunity that then you want to realize. Mm-hmm. And then think about potential options, bring together different stakeholders that then they come like from different sectors. And then by bringing together these different perspectives, then there's going to be a collective imagination, right? That then is going to emerge. Then if technology is going to support addressing that challenge, and then if technology is going to help to realize that opportunity, it is very important to look beyond the functionality of that technology. So then really look about the implications of that that technology on different values, because then these values, the technology, like the technologies are bringing, as we said, are really always connected to optimization, efficiency, etc. Right. So then look beyond those consequences. And if you are going to make a trade-off, think about how you're going to mitigate potential negative consequences that then you are going to identify, but go beyond like that functional use. Because then I think if you also start like looking for these frictions and potential tensions, potential unintended negative consequences, if you do it in a group, and then if you also do it in these processes that then they are participatory and then they involve multiple stakeholders, bringing together these perspectives is also going to lead to creative solutions and then things that perhaps you didn't consider before. So I think those three lessons. First, have a look at the challenge or opportunity. If technology is there, great. Look beyond its functionality and consider other values. How is society, like, and then the different levels going to be impacted, and then what can you do about it? And then definitely bring together these stakeholders to stimulate this collective imagination and then these alternative imaginaries. Because I think sometimes these projects are addressed like as a one size fits all, like, oh, this worked in Dubai, then let's bring it here to this small place, right, in a different country. Well, perhaps you need to really look at the local context. So look at the stakeholders that you have. So I think those could be there. And there to experiment, I think, as well. So then something that I have also learned in our project is that we're constantly experimenting with different methods and techniques that sometimes they are not really used. But then since as part of a research project, then that's also a very nice part of it, is like, we can find willing partners that then they are also open for this experimentation, and then you can learn a lot from it. So there to experiment, there to go out there and explore how you can organize things differently. Mm-hmm. And then you have to fail sometimes, but then you learn from it.
I love that. I always think that to be a futures practitioner or a futurist, you just have to be so curious about really everything, how it works, how it started, where it came from. And I really see that in you, such a curious and really excited about the work and passionate about the work that you're doing. Thank you so much for being part of this conversation and webinar series. What a great way to start my Thursday in this very stimulating conversation on a topic that I love, on the future of cities. So I want to thank you very much. And I'm sure all of our listeners and participants, thank you. And this was recorded, so we'll make it available to people. And we shared contact information, and do go and learn more about Julieta's projects and research. And you can see the full simulation in the link that she provided. And certainly, if you're interested in learning more about IFTF or building your own futures practice and skills, let us know. We'd like to be part of it.
It has been a pleasure. Thank you so much for the opportunity.
Thank you. Have a great day.
Have a great day.